Almost everybody who came in contact with some neurobiology might remember the basic brain areas. The frontal, temporal, parietal, or occipital lobe might come to mind. Perhaps even the brainstem and cerebellum. But what happens if you are born without one of them? Particularly, I want to look at what would happen if you never had a cerebellum in the first place. But first, let's quickly revise what the cerebellum is and where it is. As the largest structure in the hindbrain, the cerebellum can be found in the back portion of the skull. More specifically, it sits below the temporal and occipital lobes and behind the brainstem. It consists of a ventricle filled with fluid as well as a cortex covering white matter. The cerebellum can be separated into two main parts. The cerebellar cortex, being made out of folded tissue, containing most of the cerebellum's neurons. The innermost part of the cerebellum containing nerve cells that communicate information from the rest of the brain. Cerebellum translates to little brain, and it deserves this name not only for its appearance, but also for the fact that despite its relatively small size, it contains more neurons than any other region in the brain. With roughly 150 grams, it only makes up about 10% of the entire brain. However, having about 70 billion neurons, it can host up to 80% of the total ones in the brain, but mostly about 50%. It is often attributed to motor control, adjustment, and precision. However, it doesn't initiate movement on its own. Rather, it refines the motor input it receives from the brain stem, spinal cord, or the cerebrum. In addition to motor adjustments like coordination, posture, and balance, it also helps with vision and higher mental functions. Thus, all of these may get disrupted when the cerebellum takes damage. This can be caused by all sorts of things like a stroke, Parkinson's disease, infections, brain tumors, or head injury. And something you may have experienced yourself is the excessive use of alcohol. Alcohol has an immediate effect on the cerebellum and thus causes disruption to coordination, movement, and balance. Often, intoxicated people have trouble holding their balance or walking in a straight line. However, if the cerebellum takes permanent damage, it can also cause cognitive impairments, especially movement learning or concentration deficiencies. In addition to that, cerebellum dysfunction can lead to multiple movement impairments. For example, ataxia, being the loss of control over voluntary movement, tremors, here meaning the shaking or uncontrolled movement contraction, dizziness, basically having the feeling of spinning or otherwise known as vertigo, dystonia, which describes the involuntary contraction of cooperational working muscles, which often results in painful body positions. Moreover, there is ongoing research studying the link between cerebellum impairments and mental disorders like anxiety disorder, dyslexia, or even schizophrenia. But talking about the cerebellum taking damage, what happens if it wasn't there in the first place? This phenomenon is called cerebellar agenesis. It is extremely rare, and between 1831 and 1998, only 10 cases of it were reported. Since it is so rare, I would like to actually look at three of those cases in particular. For most of the other cases, the diagnosis was only made after the patient has died and it was found with autopsy. However, with these three, the diagnosis was made while they were still alive. The first here being presented by Zzmenoglu K Velioglu in the year 1998. This case report describes cerebellar agenesis found in a 22-year-old right-handed male. According to his mother, he only learned to stand unassisted by the age of 6. In addition to this, his speech was also unintelligible at that point. Moreover, he only began to walk alone by the age of 9. After only entering school at the age of 10, he learned to read and write, and that despite having shaky hands. However, here an unsteady gait was still present. Running or jumping wasn't really observed at this point. Other than that, neurobehavioral and cognitive features were normal. Although limb ataxia was present, it was more prominent on the left. Side examination revealed that he had full vision and no impairment to his visual fields. His eye movement, however, were abnormal. In addition to abnormal saccades, there was also a disruption of smooth pursuit movements to be found. Additionally, hand movements were clumsy, and performance in coordination tests, such as putting your finger to your nose or moving individual fingers rapidly, were below average. The diagnosis was confirmed by MRI scans. Let's take a look. Here you can see that the region normally occupied by cerebellar tissue is filled with cerebrospinal fluid. This led to no overall mass effect. Moreover, the brainstem laid in the normal position. Additionally, it was found that this was a case of subtotal agenesis, with a small remnant of the anterior quadrangular lobules. The second case is about a woman of the age of 24. Only by then the diagnosis was taken, meaning she lived almost a quarter decade without knowing she misses more than 50% of her neurons. And she only found out after going to the doctor for dizziness and nausea. Here, similar symptoms throughout her life were shown, as in the previous case. She wasn't able to steadily walk until she was 7 and managed to coherently speak not until the age of 6. Also, as seen previously, the patient's empty space was filled with cerebrospinal fluid. Though stating that she had trouble walking steadily, she lived a relatively normal life. This is of course astonishing, considering the fact that just as the Chinese PLA General Hospital, which reported the case, you'd think that living without such a big chunk of your brain was impossible. And of course, the opposite might be interesting to look at as well. What happens if you're missing everything except the cerebellum? But is it really that interesting? I mean, it would obviously result in death if you're missing that much of your brain, right? Well, actually, the Mediterranean University in Marseille presents a case of a 44-year-old man missing about 50 to 70% of his brain mass. However, he was living a basically normal life, having not only a wife and 2 kids, but also a job at the government. Additionally, they did some IQ testing and found out that although with 75 points his IQ was below average, he wouldn't be classified as mentally disabled. All three of those cases present a really fascinating case for brain plasticity, here meaning the adaptation of the brain to damages to the body or even itself. Because all the functions the cerebellum normally takes over are compensated for in the rest of the brain.